Please welcome the president of Stony Brook University, Dr. Samuel L. Stanley Jr.
Thank you so much, and good afternoon and welcome. One of the most exciting things about scholarship in a dynamic university like ours is the way in which lessons learned in one discipline can be applied with appropriate discretion to other fields of endeavor. As most of you know, I'm a physician and medical researcher who has spent years studying infectious diseases. When I agreed to participate in the global struggle against gender bias and violence in collaboration with UN's HeForShe initiative, I was struck by the parallels in the fight against disease. Like many diseases, gender bias is communicable, spreading from person to person and across generations. Like a disease, gender bias typically does the worst damage among the world's poorest and most disempowered. Like a disease, gender bias undermines the economic health of nations and weakens the social foundations of democracy. And like the most dangerous infectious diseases, gender bias is a global scourge that requires interdisciplinary cooperation and, crucially, the coordinated intervention of international institutions. And that's where HeForShe comes in. As one of 10 university impact champions for the HeForShe initiative, Stony Brook University is committed to taking bold, game-changing actions. Through outreach to all 64 campuses, we will positively impact the experiences of more than 459,000 students and almost 90,000 faculty and staff. Stony Brook's role in HeForShe entails collaboration with representatives of higher education, business, governments, and the United Nations to help achieve gender equality on campus and across the globe. And I want to take this moment to thank Charlie Robbins, Stony Brook's Vice Provost for Undergraduate Education, who has been spearheading this initiative both here at Stony Brook and from the entire SUNY system, and Judy Griman, Chief Deputy and Vice President for External Relations, for all of their hard work and effort on behalf of HeForShe. At the center of this initiative is today's speaker, Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka, Undersecretary General of the United Nations and Executive Director of UN Women, and we are privileged to welcome her to Stony Brook. Ms. Mlambo-Ngcuka has devoted her career to issue of human rights, equality, and social justice, and was actively involved in the movement to end apartheid in her native South Africa. She began her career as a teacher and gained international experience as a coordinator at the World YWCA in Geneva, Switzerland, where she established a global program for young women. In 1994, she was elected to Parliament as part of South Africa's first democratic government. In 1996, Nelson Mandela appointed her as Deputy Minister of Trade and Industry. She went on to become the first woman Deputy President of South Africa, overseeing programs to combat poverty and bring the advantages of a growing economy to the poor, with a particular focus on women. A longtime advocate of women's rights, she is affiliated with several organizations devoted to education, women's empowerment, and gender equality. She was appointed Executive Director of UN Women in 2013, and since then has brought her dynamic style of leadership to bear on the global campaign to achieve gender equality. She is the driving force behind the UN's HeForShe initiative. In a recent interview, she spoke of the challenges of achieving gender equality and said, "We want men to own the problem. It is not about men joining women's organizations suddenly. It is about men leading men's organizations and making sure that they engage each other on their own attitudes. It is also about making sure that the men who believe in the equality of men and women are heard, that their voices are much louder than those who do not believe." When I read those words, I thought of Stony Brook Center for the Study of Men and Masculinities, where under the leadership of Dr. Michael Kimmel, we support and promote research that furthers the development of boys and men in the service of healthy masculinities and gender equality. That is one of the many ways in which Stony Brook seeks to take leadership and set an example. Taking inspiration from UN Women and its executive director, every one of us is committed to owning the problem and the solution. I would like to conclude by recollecting that it was on this day in 1958 that the Supreme Court ordered the public schools of Little Rock, Arkansas to enroll African American students, legally ending racial segregation in the United States. The challenges facing us as we struggle toward genuine equality may be daunting, but change can be swift and sweeping when society reaches a consensus on a critical issue. With that in mind, I look forward to the opportunity to hear the executive director share her insight into how we can achieve gender equality in our lifetime. Please join me in welcoming our distinguished guest, Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka.
Thank you very much, President Stanley, faculty members, students, administrators of Stony Brook Universities, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and thank you for joining us in this lecture and hopefully a vibrant discussion after the lecture. It's an honor for me to be here to visit this partner of UN Women. Our association is very valuable, and I've been looking forward to this visit, so I'm glad that it has happened. Stony Brook University is not only our partner in gender equality, but a true pioneer in its own right in this area, because there aren't enough universities in the world that have put this issue at the center of our work. So we hold on to the few that we have with the hope of replicating your experiences and learning from them, both the positive experience as well as the challenges that you'll meet along the way. Because it is in universities that we produce thought leaders and people that can truly change the world. The university, like many other universities, offers gender studies, but it is also exciting because of the size of the campus, the fact that it's a public university, and the fact that there are leaders who lead from the front, and the fact that you have one of the unique centers for the study of men and masculinities that is led by Director Michael Kimmel, again, something that we do not find in many universities. We are here, therefore, today, not because as UN Women we think we have got all the answers, we think that the answers are going to be here in the audience. So we're here to learn. The work that is done here inspires us to think that we can begin to redefine the definition of what could be regarded as positive masculinity, but also that in a generation there is an opportunity for the world to begin again when we truly are able to ensure that the new definitions that we create will be embraced and will shape the thinking of the next generation. We are about breaking boundaries that should not only be broken by women, but boundaries that should be broken by men, women, and all other identities that we have in our communities, which must be respected and given as much support and their rights also protected. Amongst the biggest challenges that we face in the work of gender equality is the entrenched stereotypes that we find in our society. In 2015, we evaluated the implementation of the Beijing Platform for Action after a period of 20 years. One of the biggest elephants in the room that came out of that evaluation was the entrenched stereotypes that we find in every country, the richest and the poor, the most progressive and the least progressive. That therefore helps us to put forward some of the interventions that are critical across the world and in every country. What we also found was that in the last 20 years of implementing the Beijing platform, many countries passed laws that address gender equalities, created institutions that addressed gender equality, but through that, they still did not address norms and stereotype. So in many countries, you had good laws, constitution amended, living side by side with laws that were perpetuating the same problems that the new laws were supposed to implement. Between ourselves as United Nations and civil society and women's organizations in particular, we also identified the fact that we do not do enough work to address stereotype. And maybe we don't even know that well how to do that. We also found that changing of stereotype is quite critical to be an active area in which we, with which we engage young people. The creation of a man, of a program in which we engage men and boys, in which men and boys lead also in addressing the issues, is therefore part and parcel of addressing this issue of stereotype. Many studies tell us that without radical change in status quo, we're looking at more than 100 years for women to have equal opportunities in the workplace as men. In the area of women's participation in politics, if we do not get significant changes, we are talking about 55 years more before we could see equal participation of men and women in politics. We're looking at 87 years before we can achieve equal pay. Now, I don't think that people in this room can wait that long. I also think that under our watch, history will judge us very unfairly if we do not do something dramatic to change that trajectory. So HeForShe is about admitting the fact that just numerically, the number of women who are gender activists are just not enough to change the course of history. The fact that overwhelmingly, those who lead, those who have the capacity to make change, those who hold the glass ceilings, the dollar ceiling over women are men, means that you need to engage men in leadership so that they are able to use the power of one. And through that engagement, you are therefore able to spread the responsibility to bring about the change, but even more than anything else, to shorten the time it will take for us to reach the destination that we want to reach. Stony Brook is a leading champion, therefore, in our HeForShe impact, which is made up of 30 champions, 10 heads of states, 10 universities, and 10 international corporations. All of these are active leaders, they are CEOs, they are presidents of universities, and they are presidents of countries. These 30 leaders have the burden of helping us to fast-track gender equality in their respective domains. We do not expect miracle. We know that there's hard work. We have not chosen these universities because we think that they have it easier or because they are perfect, but because they've got the will to move to the next phase. They have already demonstrated that they are willing to take on the challenges. One of the exciting briefings I got earlier on was just how much the university has also brought forth the issue of gender and gendered orientation amongst students. In many universities, I have been told that some students go through their whole 4 years of university without having been in a conversation around gender. And that is truly shocking if we consider that this is one right that is violated with impunity in almost every country. To have an opportunity in this university where as you come into orientation as freshmen, you get an opportunity at least to reflect on the issue is truly groundbreaking and important for us. The champion universities, the 10 that are part of HeForShe, have made concrete commitments on what they are willing to do to address the issue of gender equality. They have committed to advancing women in the academia, addressing campus violence, building gender-sensitive campuses, and tackling the pervasive biases towards women and men in the choices of the subjects that they make, but in general, in the manner in which society deals and works with women within the broader education endeavor. In the 10 countries, the 10 companies, and the 10 universities, we also would like to see a collaboration and cross-fertilization between these three types of institutions and the leaders thereof. the 10 universities in the world that are involved in this endeavor, two in the United Kingdom, Oxford and Leicester University, one in South Africa, Witwatersrand University, one in France, Sciences Po, one in Canada, Waterloo, one in Hong Kong, the University of Hong Kong, one in Brazil, the University of Sao Paulo, one in Japan, Nagoya University, and of course in the US, two universities, Stony Brook and Georgetown Universities. I think they deserve a clap. And we would like to see them as really our game changers. No pressure, President. but we depend, and we will depend a lot on the students, faculty, community, parents, to also support these universities so that they can make the difference that we want them to make. We also see universities and young people as a bridge between the life as we have it in one generation and the life we aspire to have in the next generation and in the future. In every generation, there is actually a possibility for the world to start all over again. And this is the investment that we're helping to make. Young people under the age of 13, the majority of the population that we have in the world. Failure to invest in this constituency will be detrimental to society. Young women who are at a childbearing age actually determine the future of societies and nation. If we fail to invest in reproductive rights of those women, in girls and women's education, in ensuring that we deal decisively with the culture of violence against women, we risk losing out on this precious constituency that in many countries determine whether the country will be prosperous. Because if we do not invest in women to come out of poverty in most countries, poverty is transferred to the next generation. If in communities and in homes, women experience violence and their children are exposed to a violent life towards their mothers, it is likely that those children will emerge in the next generation as violent children and abusive themselves. If girls are not protected from unwanted and early pregnancies, and we have a population that is out of control with children that do not have parents that are ready for them, we actually create a challenge for society. I had a wake-up call visiting Niger as a country whose growth is at 2-digit of GDP, but it is getting poorer and poorer. This is because the size, the population growth, mainly as a result of unwanted and early pregnancy, outstrips the economic growth. As the country grows and has the potential to do better, it actually goes beyond because they've got all these children that are dependent, who have a long life ahead of them that will need the capacity of the state. So there is a responsibility for us in order to make sure that women's bodies are respected and that the protection that women need is actually available in all our countries. President, I hope you can allow me to brag on your behalf that this university, in making the gender sensitization training, has a potential to be a leader in this field, something that we can share with many other universities. And that as a result of the large population of the students that you are able to reach because of your campus, we can truly document your experience as in your journey. And of course, I'm also very proud that you have also committed to close the gender gap in matriculation and graduation, and that would be addressed for both men, young men and young women. Again, because gender equality is not just about what is right for women, it is also about what is right for men. We would like to see that the graduation rates and who graduates is about both those that have come from poor families, from well-off families, and that they are boys, and that they are girls, and that they are young women and young men. Stony Brook, which is part of the University of New York system, also organized a conference last year to engage all SANE campuses in the HeForShe and spread its message of global solidarity. This is something that we're truly thankful for. And again, another first that we would like to share with other universities. We will now be celebrating in September 2 years of this HeForShe campaign. We already have 250 clubs around the world in universities. And of course, we've got examples of different experiences and initiatives that have been taken by HeForShe activists around the country. Again, I want to thank Stony Brook for being one of the partners that is helping us to host this event, which will involve heads of states, it will involve corporations, it will involve universities, but it will also involve members of the community that we seek to mobilize. And through that forum, we'll be able also to exchange experiences from a chief in Malawi, who, together with the president of Malawi, are fighting to end child marriage in that country. They have been able to pass a law in Malawi. As the law was being implemented, this particular chief made sure that the children that were trapped in child marriages were released out of that yoke. They became child marriage survivors. And between us and them, we are hoping to give those children scholarships, which is their unwedding present, so that they can go back to being ordinary children. We hope some of them will end up in this university. In closing, I just want to thank the students for being pillars of HeForShe, for the different initiatives that you are responsible for in these universities, for the support that we have also received, the university has received from you, the support that we have received as UN Women from the work that we do. We obviously could not do this work if the students were not with us. I have had the privilege of working with Charlie and the other team in this university, and I truly appreciate the dedication that you have shown to this initiative. Thank you.
So thank you so much, Madam Secretary. That was wonderful. I'm going to ask a few questions, and then we'll have an opportunity for questions from the audience. So let me begin. Gender inequality is really manifest differently around the world. With so many different experiences and cultures, how do you really unite a global campaign for gender equality?
Well, there are certain challenges that women face that are common in all the countries. That makes it possible for us to have a unified campaign and global solidarity. Violence against women, unfortunately, tops the list of shared reality for many women. One out of three women in the world live with some form of violence. The highest number of women who die of unnatural causes, who are killed, they are killed by an intimate partner, and that you see across the world. Underrepresentation of women in decision-making institutions is a global problem. Also, prejudice and norms that work against women and stereotype, whether they are in the media, in the worst case scenario, there will be norms and practices such as child marriage, but it's all in the pattern of norms. Unequal pay, it's in all countries of the world, the rich and the poor, the advanced and the less advanced. So with these common transgressions, it then becomes possible for us to mount a global campaign.
Part of the rationale for including universities in the 10 by 10 by 10 impact campaign was really to engage the power of young people. How do you believe overall that young people are more open to the idea of equality?
Yes, there are pockets of conservative young people, and we really need to nurture the young people that may be conservative, but overwhelmingly, young people are much more open to change. I think one of the probably the most satisfying things that we've seen amongst young people is their openness to different sexual identities and the way that they have been able to put the issue on the table in many societies that have progressed thanks to young people and their resilience on the issue. And this we would have thought was a much more difficult issue. So the fact that they could do this is something commendable. On gender equality, again, many young people now are born into countries where discrimination is illegal. So they sort of come in expecting not to be discriminated against. I think that there are some dinosaurs like me, maybe we're born at a time where discrimination was a given. So you sort of expected this, that you would be discriminated and you'd have to fight for your rights. The kind of expectation and the standards that younger people hold themselves to and hold authority to is probably much different. And again, that is an advantage that we need to seize.
Thank you. What are the strategies that you've found successful in helping boys and men understand the impact of gender on their lives and that they too actually benefit from gender equality?
I think one of the important things is listening and communicating, making sure that men and boys who also are seriously inconvenienced by gender inequality feel understood and heard. So that it is not as if gender equality is exclusively only about looking at women's issues. Lots of, if you think that the concept of a breadwinner is about a man, irrespective of advantages and disadvantages they may have in life, it is expected that they've got to make stuff happen. Now, they may want to be a caregiver, they may want to be a stay-at-home dad, and the mom may be the rocket scientist who needs to go out and work, but the stereotype would oppress the man also to have to play a particular role. And it's important to make sure that men understand that these opportunities can actually give them also some of the choices that seem difficult for us. But also, it is important to continue to talk about rights, so that it's not about trading, that I will respect women because of this is what is in it for me. You respect the rights of people because it is the right thing to do. But you know that this argument doesn't always work, so we have to generate evidence to show how the benefits accrue to anybody. For example, in the private sector, it's been wonderful that the auditing firms have generated evidence that shows that in companies with gender diverse leadership, the companies do better, they compete better, they outperform their peers who do not have gender-based leadership. So to the extent that some men like money and they want their companies to perform very well, they don't want to leave that value on the table. They want it to go to their shareholders. So you would hope that with that evidence, they will see the advantage and the value of making sure that women are represented. If you also think about the fact that in many countries, or rather in every country where women have been able to be economically empowered, the health and the wealth of the family socially, not just economic wealth, but the enhancement of the quality of life of the family is enhanced. That obviously becomes a benefit for the whole family. So I think to universities, I think what something that you would like to ask is continuous generation of evidence, case studies, debates that actually help to project and to provide data that shows what benefits there are for society when both men and women are empowered.
So are there ways that the impact champion countries, corporations, and universities could work together to have even broader impact?
Yes, we would like that. And thank you for being part of two events that are important that are coming now in September. The one where the universities will launch their report, where they will be sharing the common activities that they are undertaking in the different universities, that begins to solidify the collaboration between and amongst universities. And I know that the people that support you as presidents at a working level have already generated a kind of a glue and that working together is happening. On the 20th of September, where you'll have private sector and heads of state, that will be the first time that we're bringing together these champions, and you'll be exchanging your stories. We are hoping that after that, the collaboration will then ensue. We know that it's a nightmare because you're all in different parts of the world and your diaries are very hectic, but we're hoping that through working with your teams, which have been exceptional, we are going to then look at ways in which we can make this a collaboration happen. So yes, it's a long yes answer.
Yes, well, we're very excited about the opportunity and greatly appreciate it. And I had the opportunity to be with you and see in Davos when the corporate group came together and made their pledges, and it was outstanding. And the kinds of things they're doing to improve transparency, which I think, again, may help increase shareholder value, to equal pay across the board for people who have the same job. Some incredible commitments were made there. So congratulations to you for really getting these companies, I think, to adopt and change. And I think you can expect the same, I hope, from the presidents of the universities and then, of course, from the heads of state as well. So I think it's working already. So is there a next stage in mind for HeForShe campaign after the conclusion of the 10 by 10 by 10 Impact Champion campaign?
Luckily, most of you did not take shortcuts. You have made projections about the changes that you want to see and casted them in a five-year framework. So we're looking at really 2020, where some of the big changes that we have committed to will show concrete results. We are proposing that sometime in 2019, we then evaluate the trends, and out of that evaluation, then we can determine where to go. But in the meantime, we obviously would like more universities, more countries, more companies to be part of the program. So we're asking our national offices to then work at a national level to motivate. But we hold you as the 30 global champions because you'll always be number one because you started first. No pressure. And we would like to see that through yourselves, we can really continue to set the bar high.
Well, we appreciate that, and we will work very hard to live up to that standard. You've really been a champion for equality, for civil rights. Was there a specific incident that inspired you to take such a leading role in the process towards gender equality?
Well, it's just probably being born in a country that had issues, South Africa, and people of my age group, if you did not participate in the struggle to end apartheid in South Africa, truly there was something wrong with you, in a way. So the issues chose me and my generation, if you like. And hard as apartheid was, I'm glad to say that out of it, we were able to learn much more about the importance of solidarity, so that you just don't fight for yourself, you fight for your community, and to also to understand that this is a long time journey, and even the fact that the people that you fight for and with will also at some point disappoint you, fight against you, fight against the beliefs that you are fighting for, but that you have to have eyes on the ball and see this as a journey in one's life. So I think that has just helped me to, even in choosing the jobs that I do, to always look for a place where it is possible to make a difference with other people. Now everybody will know how anxious I am. I mean, not anxious, ancient. I am. In 1976, I was a first year university student already. I think some people in the room were not even born. But that was the year in South Africa of the student uprising that truly changed the course of history in South Africa. And at that time, the police brutality, the killing of the students, and everything that went with that was a truly life-changing experience for all of us. And it just became important that both as students and future adults, we will finish this work, and what I've learned is that it just never gets finished.
Okay.
There's always something to fight for anywhere in the world. But I think it's better to live that kind of life of continuously trying than, you know, just accepting the injustices.
Yeah, well, thank you for your willingness to continue to fight for social justice. So you talked a little bit about the fact that, and I can't remember the exact number, but maybe was it 87 years to see equality in leadership, or did I have that one wrong? 55 for equality in leadership.
87 to equal pay, that's a lot of money women are not getting.
Yeah, that's unbelievable. Yeah. And I think something that, again, helps inspire us all. But in the United States right now, we have a chance in terms of leadership. What do you think about the possibility of electing the first female president?
Hey, look at me. My job is to fight for gender equality. The fact that in the world, there's only about 20 women that are heads of states. Come on. Can't be that there's only 20 good women in the world and the rest of good guys. So we do need to increase the number of women that are leading nations, and we know that they will make a difference. So it would be something that for us as UN women, would be tremendously exciting to see a woman in the United States. In the UN, we also have an opportunity because this is the end of term of our Secretary General, and we have 10 candidates, 5 men, and 5 women. We're hoping that member states will do their best to support women. It's looking difficult, but we're asking the women to stay in there and to fight with everything they have.
So you've had a chance now to form HeForShe, to travel, to meet in many places. What do you feel at this point in time remains the greatest challenge that arises in tackling gender equity?
The issue of committed leadership, I think, is a significantly high priority for me, because the leaders set the tone in a country, in an institution. Zero tolerance to gender inequality in an institution would enable even people that do not believe in gender equality to do it because this is the right thing to do and it is expected of them. They should not, we shouldn't put women in a situation where people will respect them because they choose to. Everyone who works in the public space must be put in a situation where they do the right thing. So the policies must be right, and the leaders must enforce the policy. So the power of one as a head of state, as a president of a university, as a head of a corporation, as a head of an NGO, it's absolutely quite critical that we have leaders who have zero tolerance. There's not even a single country where a head of state completely loses election because they do not support women. And yet, in most countries, in the electorate, more than 50% in most countries of people who vote are actually women. So there is something there that we actually need to fight for, so that the people that are voted upon respect the people who vote for them and address their issue. Then secondly, this issue of stereotype is quite deep. The fact that it cuts across cultures, it cuts across class, it cuts across nations, there is a united force that is needed by all of us, men, women, and all sexualities, to actually find the issue of equality for everybody. And I think this is where HeForShe is situated. It is yet another important intervention to address the issue of stereotype. And then the issue of investment and resources on work that has to do with women. In most countries, when a cabinet adopts a program that addresses gender equality, on average, we have found that only 10% of the required budget is allocated. The rest, the women must go bake cakes. So there's almost a dollar glass ceiling to implementing gender equality by the fact that you pass the law, you develop a program, and you just don't fund it. So there's many other issues you don't want to listen to. It's too long. Everybody will be drowsy by the time I finish. But those three, leadership, gender stereotype, and investment in gender equality-related activities, actually quite critical in my view.
Thank you. That's a great answer. So I think we can take some questions from the audience now. I think there are microphones I would ask people to go to. Please identify yourself, and again, really try and keep your questions relatively brief so many people have a chance, and students, I particularly encourage you to come forward and ask questions. So we'll begin with the young man right here.
Well, first of all, thank you so much for coming and speaking to us. And President Stanley, thank you so much for providing this lecture series for us. So both of you have mentioned that college students are more open to women's rights and gender equality. But right now, we have national statistics that show that 1/5 of college students are sexually assaulted in their time at school. How can we, as students who are here and who are passing the torch down to our future students and classmates, do things to eliminate that number completely?
Okay. Should we take a few questions
yes.
and then?
Okay, let's take more than one, mm-hmm. okay.
Yeah.
Okay, yes.
Hi, yes, thank you very much for your talk. Yes, and HeForShe has been a great initiative, especially for a conversation starter. But as you were mentioning, with the champion universities and the companies, we have the leadership and hopefully also the finances. Are there any specific policies that are being enacted by these champion places, maybe for a 5-year period to see those mm-hmm. impact? Because I feel policies have a greater impact mm-hmm. than, of course, than environment mm-hmm. change. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yes. I'm Gary Costanza. Ms. Ngcuka, I'm glad you mentioned that gender equality is a two-way street. But it's a lot worse than I'm sure you're thinking. Today, in this country, men don't have reproductive rights. And as far as female genital mutilation, that's against the law. But male genital mutilation happens every day in this country. I want to know what HeForShe or the UN is doing to actually bring about real gender equality, give men reproductive rights, as women do, and also protect baby boys from genital mutilation. Thank you.
Okay. Should we take
do one more, and then we'll, yes?
Hi, thank you for coming. I wanted to ask, with the rise of the different gender identifications, do you see that they have been integrated into the conversation of gender equality?
Okay. So maybe we can answer that?
Yes.
Let me start about the issue of campus violence as a microcosm of a broader challenge in society, because I think what we see in our campuses is what we're experiencing in society. There's a unique role for our institutions of learning to help us to break the cycle, because people who have access to higher education in every society are special. They are the ones that are likely to become leaders. They are the ones that are likely to change society. And if they leave society without having even embraced this one very important fundamental right, society is in big trouble. And it is something that I think requires a resolve on the part of the leadership, but also on the part of students, because the students also become the eyes and ears and their sister and brother's keeper in order to make sure that they, in their own right, take an active role. So I would say that there has to be a concerted effort to have programs of prevention and programs of managing the situation when there has been a transgression. The mechanisms to ensure that the disciplinary, the prosecution, and all of that happens adequately. And the coming together of these 10 universities, this is one area where we are hoping them to help us to come out with groundbreaking guidelines. We just don't have, at this point in time, groundbreaking guidelines around the world that could help us. But at the same time, I have to say that lots of universities have tried. Some of them have gone further than others, but we actually want to make it more of a rule rather than exception. We should be able to be something that we expect in every university. What happened in Stanford really just showed us how much of a challenge we still have. A prestigious university with everything, and the fact that in this particular case, and of course in the judiciary and the law enforcement. So it's a package, and the students, because they spend 3-4 times in one place, give us a real good case study for us to get everything together. And during a time when we've got leaders who care about these issues, we want to grab on them and make sure that we get as much as we can on this issue. So I'm throwing the question back to you to say we need you as students to be part of the solution, to be active. We need the policies. We need to make sure that it's a bottom-up and a top-down approach that will help us. And of course, on all of these issues that we're talking about, policies are important. The thing about policies is that they cannot make a racist respect women in the manner that we want, but they can stop a sexist or a racist person from being abusive because there's recourse. So the minimum that you could have in any situation is to have policies and to implement them, because policies set the standard and they can become a deterrent. On the issue of what policies we expect from HeForShe, we are hoping that in the implementation of gender equality, be it of faculty or students, universities have worked out already some percentage or levels of representation that they are aspiring for. So that already gives us some kind of measurement. In some cases, it can be a policies. In some cases, it will be a vision or an aspiration, but some kind of a measurable initiative is actually required, because what you can't measure, you usually cannot really enforce. So we have seen that to some extent, and some of it is reflected in the report that they will be launching on the 19th. On the issue of men and female discrimination, As I would imagine, when you are talking about a male mutilation, you are probably talking about circumcision of men. I don't know enough about the U.S. to have an opinion, but I can tell you about my own country, where FGM is illegal, but circumcision of young men is not illegal, because our medical practitioners, the WHO, based on the research that they've done and in tracking how it happens when boys are, and I'm including my own sons in that list, because I also supported for them, it has helped to reduce the infection of HIV and AIDS amongst young men in my country.
That's still general mutilation.
Yeah, but I think it is important, because these...
human rights violation.
You have to let our speakers speak.
Yes,
please.
But I mean, I think that we actually need to protect. I don't want my children to have HIV and AIDS.
We have condoms.
Well, it's not the answer for everybody, unfortunately. It's not the answer for everybody.
You know, they're doing it right across the street here. Mutilation.
So I think
you need to bring in the law enforcers into it. So I would support that where there is a violation, especially when the children are underage, where the parents are not involved, where the medical profession is not involved, where you do not have ethical and hygienic conditions, when you cannot prove that there is a result that serves any purpose, absolutely. Absolutely, I would agree. Oh, sorry, there was a...
I think you got everything.
The last question?
Well, I think that was about policies, and I think...
Okay.
Gender identity. Oh, yes, thank you.
Yes, It's not, I think, where you really want it to be. I think the role of young people is actually quite critical, because I think it is young people that are helping us to set the bar much higher. In the UN, for example, we have been able to set the policies for the UN itself as an institution. but we have not been able to set policies that all member states adopt in their own countries. So it is a battle in the United Nations. You will know that there are many countries where people are actually killed because of their sexual orientation, where countries pass laws to discriminate and to do all kinds of horrible things. So it continues to be one of the areas where we have violations of human rights. And when this debate happens in the UN, you can actually see the United Nations literally becoming divided across the board. Usually it is of religious ground, it is a cultural grounds, and once sometimes you while when you add up the number of countries that will take a position one in one way or the other, it is frighteningly significant, I'm afraid. I don't think that it is an overwhelming majority, but because you hardly ever vote in the UN for some of these things, there's a lot of consensus. Even when we've got a few countries, they can actually hold decision like this, and you are unable to move forward. So you do need advocacy of the public in general, so that you are not only dependent on what happens inside boardrooms and conference rooms and the, in the halls of diplomacy. It is also what happens in the streets and in the community that will influence the proceedings inside the closed rooms and the corridors of power.
Yes.
Hello, my name is Nikki. I'm thanking Executive Director for joining us here today. I know that a large issue worldwide is the lack of educating young girls, and that providing education for young women around the world can cut so many issues that we face, whether it be abuse, whether it be early pregnancies, et cetera. I know that patriarchy is ingrained in the societies and governments of other countries around the world, and by the UN and the US trying to spread the idea of gender equality, a lot of people take it as, oh, you're trying to enforce Western ideals on us. But how do you think that we can combat trying to provide and trying to encourage other countries to educate their women without, enforcing a Western idea on them?
Hello, thank you so much for coming. I feel like most people, I feel like most people agree that there's an issue around gender, but how would you recommend that we engage with people who feel that there isn't an issue and that this is all some sort of excuse or it's all made up? How can we engage with those people in a way that isn't, there's no conflict, that sort of can have a fruitful conclusion or discussion? Mm-hmm.
Hi, my name is Ishani Garadio, and thank you so much for coming. My question was, you had mentioned stereotypes and popular culture and mass media infiltrate so many of these stereotypes every day. And because it is so prevalent, as young adults, what do you think is the best way that we can avoid the misconceptions socially constructed by the songs and movies that we listen to on a daily basis, even the Fetty Wap concert tonight? How can we evade something that's so prevalent around us? Thank you.
Okay. My name is Percy. It's a great honor. I'm actually a South African, and I have a question as well. So I think most of the problems that we probably have in society begin even before we get to university to become students here. With the work that you're doing with the UN, how successful has been project where people actually started teaching about gender equality or social justice issues rather in school? And incorporated as part of a compulsory curriculum rather than the electives that we get to take here. So you can take gender as an elective at university or a class on racism. So how effective is it when they actually try to do this sort of work as compulsory school curriculum?
Can I answer?
Yes, okay. Good.
Well, I'll be biased and start with my countrymen. on starting early with addressing gender equality, we are engaged with UNESCO, and I hope that when we have our meeting on the 19th, because you will meet the head of UNESCO, this is one of the things that we will be discussing. We have asked that UNESCO and the ministers of education in the world embark on a curriculum change that takes into account issues of gender equality, but at the same time, do it in such a way that you do not have pushback, as some other countries may feel that it is too centralized. But to the extent that there's a majority of countries that believe in gender equality, this is about giving the tools to do it. Also ensuring that at a teacher training college level, because I think this is where we lose the plot, we unleash teachers to schools that are probably not very well vested with the subject, and so we send people that will reinforce this stereotype. I myself feel that the investment in teachers, and this is the discussion that we're having with UNESCO, which I think then they will bring to universities, we really need to make sure that the curriculum for teacher training, in the same way that we don't expect and don't want teachers to be racist and so on, we need to invest in it so that they graduate with it. I mean, I did my PhD research on this subject, on teachers and technology, and how technology is also not neutral as a teaching tool. I was amazed in my own country, relatively progressive, just to the extent to which teachers did not see the connection between the value system that we have in our constitution and the kinds of things that they tend to teach about. So I agree with you, and we're trying to make sure that we start very early. On the issue of preparing how to make sure that we deal with gender stereotypes as girls and young women, I think that it's important that we make work as girls and as boys, as young men and as young women, so that this does not become a problem of women and girls only. This is a societal issue, and we need to bring both men and boys, boys and girls together. It is important that we always speak up when we see double standards and gender inequality being accepted, being normalized. It is important that in our institutions, especially where we are, we point out these issues and we engage with the relevant authorities to help us to address these issues, because there is hidden bias in society. And the only way we will create a body of knowledge on how to deal with this is if we do this over and over and over again. This is something for which there isn't a shortcut. And to the media, again, we have to continuously engage the media. I am very interested, the city of New York is doing a course for journalists on how to cover issues, especially issues of violence against women. And the journalists that will participate in that program will have to write a story, and the one who writes a winning story will get a prize. But that will be their first start on trying to curate a course that they hope to take to schools of journalism, so that the experts in teaching journalism can actually use it. So you actually need different entry points to do this, starting early, tackling people when they're already in their professions, making sure that you have policies, because gender inequality is complex. You therefore need a comprehensive response to deal with it. On the issue of taking the issue of gender equality to countries where there is a problem of girls' education, and making sure that it is embraced and not seen as a foreign concept. Firstly, I have to say, in the last 20 years, again evaluating what has happened in the last 20 years in the implementation of gender equality related initiatives, one area where there has been progress in addition to legislation has been in girls' education. We're not where we need to be. The quality is not good. The dropout rate is still a problem. But it is one area where we saw the biggest number of progress, especially in countries that started at the bottom, who had a lot of barriers to overcome. So at the very least, where countries don't do well there, it is not out of active resistance of lack of trying, except in those countries where there is extremism, where you've got Boko Haram, for instance, in parts of Nigeria, who see girls' education as something to fight against and to kill for. That then becomes an extraordinary situation. But in most parts of the world, this is something that governments are willing to do something about. And given how powerful in education is, and maybe I'm biased because I'm a teacher, this is actually one area where I think we need to give it our all. As it stands now, the projections about how far in some countries we will be able to go with girls' education in the next 50 years are still not good. We have probably just as much a chance of moving forward in some of the country, just as we have in some of the countries not to get anywhere to where we want to get. And one of the barriers is child marriages because of how much it still remains a practice in many countries. And that is why, again, in HeForShe, for some of the countries where there is the practice is prevails, we are asking the heads of states in those countries to make that one of their biggest intervention. So the situation is sort of unequal, and it is the progress in some countries. We can see that there's dedication and there's a push, and we think that in the next 5 to 10 years they'll make progress. But I am afraid that there are some countries where we still can see that we're going to have problems. And again, I bring men into it. We are then mobilizing men, a country like Egypt, working very hard to get men in the mosque and everywhere in society to tackle this issue. We want men to be the ones that come forward and say, I will not marry a child. I will not beat up a woman. I will not tolerate or accept sexual violence against women. So that the prevention is actually coming from the potential perpetrators themselves. So again, I don't have a clear answer to that, except to say there's just a lot of work, enough for all of us to do much more than we are already doing on all of these issues that you have identified. I hope I've answered all the questions.
So that was inspiring. I want to thank you so much for coming to Stony Brook today.
Thank you.
Thank you for all of your inspiring words. Thank you for your leadership, and thank you for making Stony Brook University a part of HeForShe.
Thank you for having us. Thank you so much. Thank you.